She's waiting on the theater to scan, you know, she had to get it done with her second round, she wanted radiation. They had to do the scan, she had to see if it's down. And then they said.
So she's just.
Good morning.
Yeah, he said it was so nice after he said it was about 40, but he said there was no wind. And he said they had cocoa bombs.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Today is the Transfiguration of our Lord, so the midpoint, high point of the season of Epiphany. Just a few announcements before we begin. Little Lamb's registration for next year has opened up. Information is in the bulletin on that. In-person Bible study is resuming, so if you want to stick around after service, we will be engaging once again in theory after we get past questions. The book of Exodus. So we're at Exodus 19. I looked it up. So that's what we'll be doing. Also, Tuesday night, we're going to get together and have a dartball scrimmage. You guys should know the drill by now. Social distance, wear your mask. If you've been sick, don't come, so on and so forth. But if you wanted to learn about dartball, Tuesday night is the night. And only one more thing, and not the least important. I do want to thank Janet for filling in today. Paul is doing well and improving, but thank you for coming on over all the way from Dwight. And so, the mask, I can't tell if she's smiling or not. She could be glaring. Okay, so, but thank you again for coming on over and all that. Our order of service would be Divine Service Setting 4, as printed up in our bulletin. Let us begin with hymn number 397. As a gladness medical. Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
I confess to God Almighty, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I pray God Almighty to have mercy on me, forgive me all my sins, and bring me to everlasting life. Amen.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, grant you pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all your sins.
Amen.
I confess to God Almighty, before the whole company of heaven, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned in thought, word, and deed, by my fault, by my own fault, by my own most grievous fault. Wherefore I pray God Almighty, have mercy on me, forgive me all my sins, and bring me to everlasting life. Amen.
The Almighty merciful Lord grant you pardon, forgiveness, and remission of all of your sins.
Amen.
Your lightnings lighted up the world.
The earth trembled and shook.
How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts.
My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord.
Blessed are those who dwell in your house,
ever singing your praise.
For a day in your courts is better than a thousand elsewhere.
I would rather be in the house of my God than dwell in the tents of wickedness.
For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favor and honor.
No good thing has he been told for those who are afraid.
Glory be to the Father and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Your lightnings lighted up the world.
The earth trembled and shook.
Transfiguration of your beloved Son, you confirm the mysteries of the faith by the testimony of Moses and Elijah. The voice that came from the bright cloud, you wonderfully foreshadowed our adoption by grace. Mercifully make us co-heirs with the King and his glory, and bring us to the fullness of our inheritance in heaven. Through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. The Old Testament reading for the Transfiguration of our Lord is Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. And he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him, the flame of a fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burned. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. He said then, Do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, Sure, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their suffering, and I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the place of the Canaanites, and Hittites, and Amorites, and Perizzites, and Hivites, and Jebusites. Now behold, the cry of the people of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppressed them. Come, I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, But I will be with you. And this shall be the sign for you that I have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Then Moses said to God, If I come to the people of Israel and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, Say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 2 Peter chapter 1. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased, we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we are with him on the holy mountain. And we have something more sure, the prophetic word, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please rise. According to St. Matthew, the 17th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with them. Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them. And a voice from the cloud said, This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Rise, and have no fear. When they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, Tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Our hymn today is hymn number 414. It is good word to be here. Jesus, the light of the world. Amen. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Rise and have no fear. Thus far our text. Rise and have no fear. What an odd thing to hear. Not an odd thing to hear from Jesus, but what an odd thing for us living today in the 21st century to hear. And no, I'm not speaking to just the events of the past week or of this past year. Pause for a moment and ponder how much of our lives have been encased, ensconced in fear. Our political parties live on fear of what the other party might do. And there's been the fear of terrorism that we felt keenly since 9/11, a terrifying war on terror. What a ridiculous sounding thing. But even before that, fears of what technology will do, fear of communism or of nuclear holocaust, fear of the world war, fear of the Great Depression and drought. I think that's all of our lives, isn't it? Not too many of us were flapping it up in the roaring 20s. Almost a full century where, in spite of our progress and our growth and our wealth and our power, we've been surrounded by fear. When was the last time you could look at the news, online, or on the nightly news, or opening up the daily paper back in the day, and there wasn't someone saying to you, you need to have this fear. You need to be afraid of this. Some of those fears are real, and some were overblown. Turns out egg yolks aren't going to kill us all. It's hard to tell in the moment what is a true fear and what is overblown hype. And there's always more and more fear being poured out upon us, and pushed upon us, and dumped upon us. The mantra of this world, of our day and age, is this: be afraid. Thus, life for sinners in a sinful world. Epiphany is the season where we focus on Jesus revealing that he is true God. Whether he's alive in his Father's house, or there's the voice from heaven at his baptism, or it's water to wine, or if there's a later Easter, other miracles follow. The high point, the apex of the Epiphany season is today, is the Transfiguration. And there's a lot that's going on in our text that points to Jesus being true God. There's so much wonder and awesomeness. But my friends, don't miss the true high point. The true thing that emphasizes that Jesus is true God above all others. Look for it. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. The beginning of the revelation starts right here. We miss it because we don't live in an old-fashioned paganism, but going up on a mountain was a key, a sign that something divine and wondrous was going to happen. Temples were always on mountains, not in valleys. So hearing this introduction, we'd expect something cool to happen. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. There he goes. The Transfiguration. Jesus starts shining. He starts glowing. Well, surely there's the proof that he's true God. But it is a neat thing. And we often think of this as the highlight, yes, I did say highlight, of the Transfiguration. But things like this have happened before. Angels shine. Moses glows with the reflected glory of God after he comes down from Mount Sinai. It's cool. It's Jesus' own divinity and not a mere reflection shining, but there's more beyond this in this text. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. This is actually even cooler. This is even more profound. Moses is there. Elijah, the greatest prophet, is there. Basically, two of the Mount Rushmore folks from the Old Testament are suddenly there, and they're talking to Jesus. You have Jesus speaking forth and dealing with eternity. You have the Word of God dealing personally with folks who wrote the Old Testament. This is a mighty, powerful revelation of who Jesus is, that he is indeed true God. And one might be excused for thinking that the story could end right here on this fantastic high note and swelling music, and isn't this just so cool? But it doesn't. Peter chimes in. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." Now, there's a logic to what Peter suggests here. This is around the time of the Festival of Booths, where the children of Israel would camp out and remember their wanderings in the wilderness. So Peter offers to get ready for this. And yet, it is one of the most idiotic, absurd things in all of the scriptures. Imagine that you were suddenly at some profound event. Let's say the announcement of the Declaration of Independence, and Jefferson is there reading it off to all of Philadelphia. "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created..." Excuse me, TJ. Do you want me to get lunch on? Ham? Would you like ham? Would that be good? That is how absurd Peter's suggestion is. Jesus is talking to Moses and Elijah. You would give your eye teeth to be there to hear that conversation. And Peter busts up into the conversation and makes an excuse to break away to somewhere else. Utterly absurd. And yet, it actually makes sense. Still absurd, but it makes sense. Peter is afraid. It's too much. It's too profound. It's too much for sinful Peter to see Jesus shine forth a bit of his own glory. It's too much for Peter to see Moses and Elijah. It's too much to hear. So Peter does what sinful man always wants to do: run away. But God has a sense of humor. The father sees this plain out, and, "Well, Peter, since you saw fit to interrupt this conversation, allow me an interruption as well." Peter was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed him. And a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." It ratchets up even higher. The glory cloud shows up. Remember, 2 weeks ago in the Old Testament lesson, when the temple is dedicated, and the glory of the Lord descends upon the Holy of the Holies, and the priests can't get in to do their work. Well, congrats, Peter. You are now inside that cloud. Something that Moses and Elijah couldn't bear to do their earthly days. It gets even higher. The Father himself speaks. Listen to Jesus. Up and up and up it goes, revealing that Jesus is true God. Down, down, down with Peter, James, and John. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. They assumed the position. They expect to die. Duck and cover. You Cold War kids know the drill. Get under the desk, close your eyes, and await the flash of light and the end. The fear, the terror, the reality of being a sinful, mortal human being condensed and compressed into one fantastic, terrifying point. That's where the disciples are. Now, finally, we are ready to get to the high point of this text, the point where Jesus fully shows himself to be true God. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." When they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. This, my friends, is the point, the apex of Jesus revealing who he is. The shining, the saints of old, the glory, that's actually all secondary. All of that could in fact be terrifying or bad. But right here, this is the thing. Jesus touches them, and he says to them, "Rise and have no fear." This Jesus, this man who is also true God, he's come for you, for your good, to be your God, for your benefit. He's come to rescue you. Deliver you from the fear that swirls around in this world. Fear is the speciality of the world. It is its power, the levers the world wields to push and prod and drive us all over. And so often we get caught up in those fearful games. But you do not belong to the world. You do not belong to Satan and to its terror. You do not belong to death. This is because Jesus Christ has come to you. He has hatched his word, listen to him, his word to water. He's touched you, he's claimed you as his own. You belong to the triune God, not the world. You belong to he who is the resurrection, the life. You do not belong to death. You are clothed in the robes of Christ's own righteousness, and your sin is no more, for it has been obliterated upon the cross. This is the truth, the reality of who you are. And yet we're still in the world. And the world will keep on spinning fear at us. It has all our days till now, and it will for the rest of the days that God grants us here. Now, what that fear will look like, how real and how dangerous it will be, I don't know. But here's the thing, my friend. Even if that fear ends up becoming real and close and dangerous, even if it condenses down to a fine, dagger-sharp point and closes in upon you, even when it drives you to close your eyes in death, so be it. Jesus Christ is true God. He is true God for you. And you know what this true God does? He touches his disciples, his friends, his loved ones. And he says to them, "Rise and have no fear." It doesn't matter what the world throws at you. You will hear Jesus speak these words to you, and you will rise, and you will have no fear. And instead, you will simply delight in all the gifts of the life of the world to come, right along with Moses and Elijah and Peter and James and John and all the saints who have gone before us and all the saints who have yet to be baptized into our joyous throne. But for now, our lives as Christians, just practice, preparation, reminders of what is to come. Rise and have no fear. You will hear it. For Jesus, true God and true man, has died and risen for you. Rise and have no fear. In the name of Christ Jesus, the light of the world. Amen. Please rise. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We confess our common Christian faith via the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the baptized, that we would heed our Heavenly Father's admonition to listen to His Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, as He speaks to us through His holy word and sacrament, and that we would, by grace through faith, behold Him in glory as He continues to tabernacle among us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are called and ordained to serve in Christ's stead and by His command, that their preaching and teaching would flow from a right understanding that all Scripture testifies of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For parents in every Christian home, that they would pass on the faith for their children by word and deed, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have been placed in authority over us, including Joseph, our president, J.D., our governor, and all other officials, that they would serve with integrity and honor, having the welfare of all in mind, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our country, that division, conflict, and strife would give way to unity, peace, and quietness, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Lord's flock here at Trinity Lutheran Church, that we would be granted faithfulness, humility, and patience in our various vocations, striving to love God and neighbor in all that we say and do, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who are sick, hospitalized, recovering, enduring ongoing treatment, or suffering in any way, especially our brothers and sisters, Benny, Kaylee, Grady, Diane, Evelyn, Raven, Doris, Genevieve, Lois, June, Mike, Carolyn, Harley, Dorothy, Donald, Violetta, Mary Kay, Maggie, John, Glenn, Leslie, Paul, Jeff, Jamie, Penny, Grace, Bonnie, Darcy, Jack, Lisa, Melissa, Donna, Marianne, Darlene, Connie, Lynn, Verla, Audrey, Dorla, Carrie, Hugh, Donna, Merlin, and Chris, that they would receive peace and healing and relief according to God's gracious will, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
All this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. For through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death, will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, given your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. As the glory of your presence once filled your ancient temple, so in the incarnation of your Son, Jesus Christ, you manifested the fullness of your glory in human form. We give you thanks that in his most holy supper you reveal your glory to us. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, so that we may one day behold your glory face to face. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he is called. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
Please rise. We give thanks to Almighty God that you have refreshed us through this dietary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy would strengthen us through the same in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
We will conclude singing hymn number 412, The People That in Darkness Sat.
Thank you.
my annual one, Brownie. That's a pretty short one.
Thank you, Janet. You did very well. We appreciate it.
Wave at the camera, Dale.
All right. Bye, everybody.